center of the universe and the Thrive15.com world headquarters.
Let's go!
Presenting the world's only business school without the BS, with optometrist and entrepreneur Dr. Robert Zoellner and the former Small Business Administration Entrepreneur of the Year in your ear, Clay Clark. It's the Thrive Time Show on Talk Radio 1170. 3, 2, 1.
Boom, 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 and boom. Welcome back to the Thrive Time Show on your radio. My name is Clay Clark, the former USSBA Entrepreneur of the Year, sent here on a mission to get you into a great financial position. And as always, it is ecstasy when the Z is next to me. Dr. Zoellner, how are you, my friend?
I am so excited. I'm so happy. I'm so fired up.
Oh, I can feel the fire.
Can you feel the fire?
It's too hot.
Too hot.
And we also have one of Tulsa's premier business coaches.
Whoa. I got to tell you why.
Why?
Well, my old computer died a few days ago.
Yeah, it did.
And so we had a burial. We had a ceremony. It was, you know, it's when you lose a computer, it's a sad day.
You know,
it's a sad day.
It is. Well, when you back it up, though, it's a little less sad.
We did. Yeah, true of that. But we did over 270 shows or two. What are we up to now? 260 something?
We're at 270. This will be 270.
Okay,
today.
So almost 270 shows. That laptop and I trudged through them.
Yeah, you guys.
It was like my sidekick.
It was, and that was one of the original laptops of all time. It was actually made of wood, and it was from the 80s.
Yeah, and Noah, I think Noah had it. He used it to
keep inventory.
Animals.
Yeah,
keep inventory.
A lot of people don't realize that the algorithms that God gave Noah were fairly complex, and so he used an original Mac laptop.
Yeah, a Mac.
Extra thick.
Yeah, exactly.
To do his calculations.
Yeah, and so it died, so I got a new one, but I didn't have, the first day I had it, I didn't have all my buttons on there.
All the sound effects.
And now the guys, you put it on your checklist, on your workflow, and you said, I'm going to put that on my thing, my get done list.
Yeah.
And I come in today to the studio, and guess what?
It's updated.
I've got my buttons. I can play all my silly little sounds.
Shout out to the angelic Marshall Morris, business coach.
It's the little things in life anymore that just kind of make me.
Can I say this real quick? Let's make it a challenge that on today's show.
Okay.
That you will hit the buttons over 50 times.
Once every segment, at least.
Eight's
fair.
I think over 50. I think so, because you already hit it once.
Well, it wouldn't be annoying.
No, it wouldn't be annoying. The guests, the listeners are excited. They want to see, can you, let's say we get to 20.
I can't promise 50, but I'm gonna do my best.
There's people counting right now.
Okay. That's fair.
All right. Now, before we get into today's show, which is the art of getting things done, I have a special announcement I want to make for all the great listeners out there from the left coast of the Arkansas River.
Well, you know, I interrupted your introduction of Butterchup over here, so.
You want me to go back in time and to reintroduce Eric Butterchup, the man who needs no introduction?
Well, that's what I feel bad about. You were starting to then go down the line here. You introduced me, and then you were going to Chup Chup over here, and then I jumped in and said why I was so excited.
It's okay. I'm not too worried about it, though.
I mean, he's a great business coach. He's our new little partner. Okay, if you're Batman and I'm Robin, what does that make him?
Kind of a big deal.
Kind of a big deal.
Let me read you a poem I was working on for you, Errol.
Maybe the Joker. Maybe he's the bad guy.
Why do you build me up, Butterchup baby?
Butterchup.
To let me down.
Build me up.
And mess me around. And then worst of all, Chup, you never call Chup when you say you will. But I love you still. I need you, Z. We need him.
I need you.
More than anyone, darling. You know that I have from the start. So build me up, Butterchup. Don't go breaking my heart.
Well, I know this is a radio show, but I'm speechless.
Oh, no.
I don't even know what to say to that.
Just sit there quietly.
Just smile.
Now, back to my special.
Oh, okay.
Back to
go.
My special announcement. Okay. I've been working with the Farmers Insurance agents. I've been training them as a business coach for year 9. 9 years training the District 10 Farmers Insurance agents, getting them matriculated, coached up, ready to go out there into the marketplace and to sell a premium insurance product to confident planners.
I just prefer to play some farm music because it's farmers.
Oh, I see what you did there.
And so today, Kirk Fryer out there at District 10, he actually got a new coffee maker.
Oh,
now,
okay.
For 9 years, we had the same one. Now, this new, I walked in today, and I'm like, there's something that feels different. I look to my left. I look to my right. I make my way to the coffee maker, and there it is in all its glory.
Wow.
A new coffee maker after 9 years.
That's big.
No, he doesn't do Keurig. He doesn't mess around with that. No, you got to put in the beans.
Is it a person? The coffee maker is a new person?
It's a machine, but it's, it's the old school where you still have to pour in the you know, the Folgers stuff. But it's a new one. It's a new old school one. So that, to me, was a highlight. I mean, it's the little things.
It's the little things like that.
It's the buttons.
It's the buttons.
The Folgers.
I'm the whole show. Everybody out there in Thriveland will be able to listen to my smile because it's on my face. It's going to be on my face the whole show.
You guys are crazy.
I got my buttons.
Well, okay. Now today, what we're talking about the art of getting things done. If you've been listening for the last few shows, we left you yesterday on move number 50. So today we move on. There's 66 ways to get more things done. Each one of these moves, if implemented, could at least save you an hour of your week. Now, here is the next move, move 51. When you hear the phrase committee, run for the hills. Now, Napoleon Hill once wrote a book called Think and Grow Rich. In the book Think and Grow Rich, Napoleon Hill, he was the personal apprentice of Andrew Carnegie, one of the world's wealthiest men, one of the world's most effective men, a man who got a lot of things done. And he said this, Napoleon Hill writes, opinions are the cheapest commodities on earth. Everyone has a flock of opinions ready to be wished upon anyone who will accept them. If you are influenced by opinions when you reach decisions, you will not succeed in any undertaking. Z, why do you have to run for the hills when you hear the word committee?
Time waster. Time sucks.
See, this is what I felt. I have felt that there is nothing more unproductive than these business situations where we form a committee or a task force to run around playing, you know, a certain game that involves grabbing, you know, derrieres, let's say. But what happens is people will literally, they'll say, you know what, this year's holiday party, what I want to do is I don't want to make a bad decision, so Buttercup and I, we're going to team up on that. And what we'll do is we'll circle back next Tuesday, but we are going to research the top venues and the top gifts, the top, you know, party favors. And then the next week we come back and you're like, okay, guys, what are we doing? And I'm like, oh, I thought.
Well, I wanted to do this, and Chep wants to do that. And
what do you guys think? Let's open it up for discussion.
You know, we're not sure because we may not have found the perfect spot. So someone else probably needs to weigh in.
Let's open it up for discussion.
We need to increase the size of the committee because we want everyone to be able to.
What are your thoughts, Carl?
Have an opinion about the party.
Now, Carl's currently on his cell phone. You know, so when you ask Carl, what do you think? Carl goes, what?
What?
Huh? And you say, Carl, what are your thoughts about this year's holiday party? And this is what Carl will say. Because he just got off his cell phone. He's playing it off like we all didn't just see him get off the cell phone.
Yeah.
But he says, this year I think we should do, and he's trying to come up with something kind of deep because he just got called out in the meeting. You know, he says, this year what we should do is we should do something different. And you're like, well, why should we do it different? I mean, for 25 years, you know, Dr. Z's been having his holiday party. He has a DJ. He has music. He has good food. He has drink tickets. He gives away a lot of things. And, you know, let's mix it up, though. I just want to do something different. You know what I mean? And I was, and all of a sudden, like, oh, that's good. Now it's groupthink because there's another person who just validated Carl, his buddy Craig, who you hired last week. And Craig goes, yeah, we should. We should. And then the third guy in the back, you know, his name is Gus. Gus, he's an older guy. And he's like, yeah, absolutely. I've been saying that for years. And all of a sudden now you got eight people going, yeah.
And then you say, well, okay, what do you want to do? I don't know. We'd have just to make fun.
Why don't we make a committee and we'll think about it.
Yeah, we'll get it.
It doesn't work. Chep, you business coach with clients, and you've had clients that have come in. They've brought in large constituencies, large entourages, large democracies,
right,
and they've decided that they're going to go ahead and run it by everybody before making a decision. Can you talk about the perpetual dysfunction of large group decisions?
Yeah, so a lot of times business owners will do this as they're growing. They want to include their team in the core decisions of the business.
And the core.
When we started talking about this, funny, Z said it was a time suck. I wrote a little note down here that says, this will suck your time. Like, it's just going to be a time waste. You're going to come up with endless ideas that are not practical, that aren't going to make you money. So get out of there. Don't do it. It's a terrible idea.
And let me give you an example of what will happen if you do this. Z, what's your favorite? I mean, you went and saw Bruno Mars. You love Prince. You strike me as a guy who appreciates all genres, but I think you genres. Do like R&B pop, don't you?
Yeah, I do, but I like all genres, yes.
But if you had to choose, I mean, gun to your head, you had to choose one genre, what's your favorite genre?
Yeah, probably R&B pop, you know, kind of dance, kind of music that kind of makes you kind of want to tap your toe.
Like What'll Be Your Lover by Prince?
Yeah, that's
a good song, you know.
Yeah.
So you and I, we share that aura, that zone. We understand what it means to group. We get it.
Yeah.
But there's somebody else on the team. They go, well, this year for the holiday party, why don't we all make a list of our favorite songs?
I was hoping for George Strait.
Our favorite songs. Why don't we all? You know, and there's really only like so many very concerned.
Polka music. You know?
So this is what's going to happen. We're at the holiday party. All right, guys, welcome to Dr. Zoellner's holiday party. Everybody get ready to go. We're going to start off with the chicken dance. And everyone's going, oh my gosh.
Oh my gosh.
And then it goes, and now, folks, we're going to play some German classics, David Hasselhoff's Unheard album, his previous album. It's a phenomenal song. I'm going to go ahead and play it for you. And he literally had an album, and it literally is horrible. And so now we're playing that, and so that no one gets forgotten, we're going to go ahead and play Shania Twain, track 7 on her latest album, the one that really never made it to radio, but her best one, in my opinion.
In my opinion.
Right, Karen? Right.
Right.
And so there's never a groove.
Well, you know what's so fun about this year's Christmas party? That now that you brought it up and you've talked about it so much.
Yes.
It's going to be at a magical place in town.
Oh.
And you guys are going to be there.
The historic
will be there.
It's going to be the historic, wonderful, glorious
Mayo
Hotel in the Crystal Ballroom.
Oh.
And it's as swanky as it sounds.
It is swanky.
In fact, I have to talk like this.
Just when you mention
it. When I'm talking about it.
It is a swanky place. It has a lot of history.
Yeah, so it's a lot of fun. The crew's excited, and a lot of them are doing kind of a cool move. They're actually getting a room there because it's a historic hotel. So that way they don't have to worry about Ubering or drinking and driving.
Be responsible.
Real quick, the hotel was built in 1925. Do you know that?
That's a long time ago.
1925.
I think.
I know. And so it's
I laid the first brick. I'm that old.
Oh wow, that's incredible.
A lot of people don't know that. But I was
you were a mason.
I was on the work crew.
Original.
He was a Freemason though. He wasn't
not an enslaved mason.
None of that, yeah.
Right, absolutely. He worked with the Illuminati to put in the first brick.
Oh no, here we go.
Freemason.
Right.
Okay. Oh, no. So again, to avoid the committees. Now move 52. Don't suffer death by got a minute meetings. Chet Holmes, the best-selling author of the book The Ultimate Sales Machine. He was a partner of Charlie Munger, who's Warren Buffett's partner. He says, cut out the got a minute meetings and tell employees to hold it for the weekly meeting or the daily meeting. But do not succumb to the pressure of got a minute meetings. Again, there's a bunch of questions. Tell the employees, he says, tell your employees, cut out the got a minute meetings and tell the employees to hold it for the standing meeting. So, hey, Craig, Carl, everybody, I know you'll have questions. That's awesome. Every day at 4:00 when we do our end of the day meeting, ask me then. See, why is it so important you cut out the got a minute meetings if you want to grow your business beyond just surviving?
Oh, boy, they are the worst. What happens is you get caught in the hallway. Hey, you got a minute? And,
at first,
like, you don't want to be rude, right?
Hey, do you have a minute?
Well, technically, I have a minute. They never last a minute, the problem.
Hey, do you have 2 minutes?
I mean, you're in there like 20 minutes later, and this person's just wailing about someone talking about them on Facebook that they works in the department next to them, and da-da-da, and you're just like, oh, my gosh.
Hey, do you have 3 minutes?
Yeah.
Hey, no, seriously, I got this rash. You got to look at this. This is crazy. This is like a tier one here.
It itches real bad.
Hey, see, I have a question. Late. How do you make this app work?
Yeah, and anymore I don't get caught in the hallways anymore. I don't do the got-a-minute meetings.
Hey, who's saying that? So, real quick question. is your real name Z, or is it just something like a phone name?
Are you a real person? Because people ask us that all the time.
Hey,
are you really real?
Hey, real quick, do you want to go to Brahms? Do you want to go to Taco Bueno? Hey, do you notice the signs off to the left? Hey, do you have a second? Hey, I sent you an email. Hey, you got
to
stop it.
How do you handle them, Clay? You know, when someone comes up to you here in our Thrive Time headquarters here on the
You know
left
what
bank
I'm going
to
do? When we come back, I'm going to talk about the dark art of dealing with got-a-minute meetings.
Cliffhanger.
Yes. I have a lot of moves. And many of which I'm sure I'm going to get beat up for the ethics of my moves.
Are they mean moves?
Well, they're moves that I don't like. I said that
you physically
punching, kicking,
punch somebody.
No, they're moves. They work well. It's kind of like the up and under for Kevin McHale. I just use the same moves over and over my entire Hall of Fame entrepreneurial career. My name is Clay Clark. I'm a business coach. Stay tuned. Learn how to get out of those got a minute meetings.
Get ready to enter the Thrive Time Show on Talk Radio 1170.
Cash, cold, that's what I need to say. I want money, lots and lots of money. I want the pie in the sky. I want money, lots and lots of money. So don't be asking me why. I want to be rich.
Oh yeah, Thrive Nation. If you want to be rich, you're going to have to get things done. In fact, you don't get paid for the number of hours you work. You get paid for the value that you add to the hours.
When you are the business owner, That is what it's all about.
Yes.
And really, you know, for the most part, really any worker out there, because you get raises based upon what you're doing extra. You know, it always amazes me when people come up to you and they want a raise because they've done their job well.
Well, yeah, it's like, hey, I've done my job well, now it's time for a raise. Had I done my job poorly, I wouldn't ask for a deduction. And the days I did a bad job, I don't want a deduction. But the day, I mean, I've done it.
Killed it a few days last week, so I should get more money.
I mean, I phoned it in yesterday, though, so I guess it evens out. I don't know.
Talking about move number 52 in the art of getting things done is don't suffer death by got-a-minute meetings. And so, Z, you asked, what are the moves that I do to avoid these situations, okay? So this is my move number one, to avoid the got-a-minute meetings.
Okay,
I observe the org chart as much as possible and almost with a religious fervor. So as an example, when
what fervor?
Almost a religious passion.
Tell me about that.
When somebody comes to me and says, do you have a minute? Hey, I have a question about this year's holiday party. I want to know, can I bring a guest? I would like to let you know and Dr. Zoellner know that I would like a turkey or a ham, or I would like to be there or not be there, or maybe stay at the Mayo Hotel or not. I say every single time, talk to John. Because John is the next in command, and I don't want you talking to me, period.
About turkeys or hams or
about anything at all, unless you're in that org chart.
Wow.
So talk to John. I say it consistently, talk to John. In our Elephant in the Room call center, talk to Daisy. If it's the South Tulsa Elephant in the Room store, talk to Dan. I just am very into talk to the manager, because this is what I have found and something that I've gotten better at really in the last, I'd say, 10 years. I've been self-employed since I was like 18 years old. So, I mean, this is the last 10 years I've figured this out, is people will say, hey, real quick question. Do you have a minute? And then I would say, sure, what do you got? And they'd go, well, here's the deal. I had a question. Do I get a ham or a turkey? And then I would say, well, Dr. Z is clearly laid out. You can get a ham or a turkey. You just need to let John know. And then they'll say, well, now, is it organic? And I'll go, I don't know. And they're like, well, I have a gluten intolerance. And I'm like, I don't think there's gluten in turkeys. Do you know? Could you send over what kind of ham is it?
Did they inject it with gluten?
How big is the ham? And then I realize now that's a fourth or fifth. No, that's a gateway drug.
It's a gateway.
It's like, what do you like? Are they really good hams? How big are the hams?
What'd you get last year?
Right, so I'm really into just talk to John. That's one thing I do.
That smells very Elon Musk-y.
The next move I do is I say, bring that up in the meeting. Mm. I love that because usually people don't.
Okay.
So I'll say, that's a great idea. Bring that up in the meeting. It's like, I just want to talk to you. There's a smell in the bathroom. And I'm like, that's awesome. Talk to John. Well, it's really urgent. Bring it up in the meeting. I mean, It doesn't matter. It doesn't matter what music.
The smell in the bathroom doesn't matter. I mean, that matters.
And they feel kind of validated. Oh, cool. I'll bring it up at the meeting.
No, but people will say, no, I have a great idea for marketing. And I'm like, that's awesome. Bring that up at the meeting. That's great. It's awesome.
Talk to John. Bring it up at the meeting.
I talk to John first. And if that doesn't work, the next move is bring up the meeting.
Bring that up at the meeting.
Now, the third meeting, and Chuck has seen me say this probably 50 times.
Today.
I will all of a sudden speak loudly, and I will say these words. And I say it all, and it's like, is he kidding? I'll grab a third party who's not the person who's asking me, do I have a minute? And I'll say, hey, Z, I've got this rash. I want to talk to you about it. It's really out of control. It's kind of my inner thigh.
Really, that's your move.
I say, do I not, Chuck?
I brought it up earlier.
Do you really have a rash?
No, it's fun. I'll say, hey, Chuck, real quick. If someone was trying to interrupt our conversation, Chuck, I'd go, hey, Chuck, seriously, though, that rash, I want to show it to you. It's crazy. It's crawling up my inner thigh.
Follow me.
and when I say I have a rash.
Oh, good, let's go to the bathroom because I want to give you that smell.
People do that face where they're like, and they tiptoe backwards.
No, yeah. And that's the move.
That's the move. You just always throw out a rash. Does it have to be on the inner thigh? That seems a little kind of, you know.
No,
it could be like on your back or.
No, and these are moves. I mean, I'm just going down the moves because I do these moves all the time. Chip, you see it. So first off, if you're a player who's very good at basketball and you've lost the ability to jump because you're 30s and you're trying to play three or four more years in the NBA, you're Kevin McHale.
Okay.
Kevin McHale, the great white hope, the palest man ever, more pale than myself. He learned the pump fake where you fake and then you bring it down and you fake again and the guy tries to block it and you just keep, you're crafty now. So move number one is talk to John. That's my fake. And then if you're trying
your
to really
pump.
Block me, then I'm going, bring that up in the meeting. And I'm faking.
Boom, boom.
Then the
Another
third
pump.
That almost never loses. I'm like, I have a rash.
You feigned sickness.
Chuck, let's go talk about my rash real quick. I need to talk.
I'm excited.
Now the fourth, now this these are progressively more intense, but I do them all the time. Fourth move is it's a crazy. I suggest a crazy time to meet. Hey, great idea. Why don't we meet tomorrow at 4 a.m.? Let's talk about it. Because I always get up at 4 and no one else will. I do that a lot.
That's the answer that they get.
Yeah, they're like, oh, yeah, we'll just bring it up in the meeting.
I'll go talk to John.
Yeah. Now, the other one is this is probably the dirtiest move, but I do it a lot. And I probably do it at least twice a day. It's the fake incoming call.
Oh, yeah, that's a great one.
So I'll just like, Billy, absolutely. You know what? You know, just walk off.
Yeah. The only thing as bad as when you're doing the fake incoming call is when you actually get a call during your fake call and your phone starts to ring.
No, that's a switchover. Hey, Billy, I got to switch over.
Well, it doesn't ring out loud, though.
You got to stay in character.
Oh, yeah.
My ringer's always off.
Oh, I know. Your ringer's always off.
Right. So here's the deal. So move number one, again, if you're writing these down, one is you just say, hey, I got to absorb that. You say, hey, John, you talk to John. Talk to your manager. Talk to whoever. Absorb that org chart. Don't let people circumvent that thing.
No.
The second, just say, hey, bring it up in the meeting. These are rational moves. But if somebody wants to push on, because they really, really want to, you know, break the org chart, break the flow of the day, then I'll go, you know, Chuck, I have this rash. Can I show it to you? And they're like, never mind, I'll bring it up later. The fourth is I'll say, hey, you know, that's a great idea. Why don't we meet tomorrow at 4 a.m.? Let's knock it out. Boom. And they go, no. And then the final one is the fake incoming call. These are all moves that I do all the time. And again, I can't argue the ethics of these. I can just say Kevin McHale is kind of unethical towards the end of his career. I mean, fake one, fake two. Big guys who can jump are flying by. It's like Charles Barkley's last year. Fake.
Well, you know, one thing that I do, Clay, is that, you know, there's always that gauntlet that you know is going to be waiting for you. You know, there's always that hallway. There's always that break room. There's some space that you know you're going to get a got a minute, right?
Exactly. Yeah. Oh, yeah. Don't go there.
A lot of times I'll preempt the fake call, have the phone up to my ear.
When you walk by.
As I'm walking through the gauntlet. Having a conversation.
That's a ninja move right there.
It's kind of a pre-move.
What I want to do is I want to talk about the origin of the word gauntlet. So when we come back, I want to get into the word gauntlet. Can you throw out, hey, I got to get through the gauntlet. I know what that means, but I think it'd be fun to kind of get into the origin of that because that's something where I think if people understand the origin of that word and what that means, they'll get what I'm saying. Because as an entrepreneur, you are running through the gauntlet every day. People are just attacking you with these got-a-minute meetings, and you've
got to
get stuff done.
You've
been self-employed. You've managed a construction crew. When we get back, I want to hear about the gauntlet of distractions that you have during your day when you were running your business.
Yep.
I want to hear even now the gauntlet of distractions. And Z, as you've built several multi-million dollar businesses, there is a gauntlet of daily distractions. I'd love to hear about the things that typically are trying to kill your efficiency.
I'm sorry, I gotta take this call. I can't talk about that.
I've got this rash.
I got a rash. I gotta call my doctor about my rash.
I've got an incoming call from John Snyder at the Mayo Hotel. He says you're awesome.
Oh, there we go.
Sorry, John. John, I'm sorry. It wasn't actually you calling. It was just a move.
Oh, we'll talk about this at 3 a.m. tomorrow. 3 a.m. We're good.
Absolutely. Hey, talk to John. Seriously, though. Bring that up in the meeting. All right, John Snyder, you're the man. We'll talk to you later. Stay tuned.
Broadcasting live from the center of the universe, it's Business School Without the BS, featuring optometrist-turned-entrepreneur Dr. Robert Zoellner with USSBA Entrepreneur of the Year, Clay Clark.
Hey, I'm on vacation every single day because I love my occupation. Hey, I'm on vacation. If you don't like your life, then you should go and change it. Vacation every single day because I love my occupation.
All right, Thrive Nation, welcome back to the Thrive Time Show on your radio. And a lot of people, they start their own business because they want to love their occupation. But then they're so good at selling, now they hire a few people. Now they hate their occupation because they're not good at managing their time and they're being bombarded, Z, by got-a-minute meetings.
Got a minute?
After the show.
Okay.
Talk to John.
4 a.m.
Talk to John.
Bring that up in a meeting.
I
have this rash.
Oh, my.
Hey, what's meet at 4 a.m. about that? Look, I'm getting a call from John Snyder at the Mayo Hotel. I got to go.
I got to go.
Okay, so here's the thing is, if you are listening to the show today and you're an entrepreneur, you're going to be interrupted during the day. And I'm going to ask Eric Butterchup, one of our business coaches, this question. And I want to ask you, Z, the question first. During your day, you said you kind of have to run the gauntlet. You said, hey, you know, during the day, it's kind of like you got to run the gauntlet. You got to try not to be interrupted. Can you explain to me the gauntlet of interruptions that you get during the day? What kind of things attack and interrupt you during the day?
Well, what happens a lot of times, I have, you know, my different businesses, I have a lot of employees, and they have ideas, they see problems, they want some of my time to fix something that they perceive as a problem. And so, not following the org chart, they want to get right to me and go to the top because then they know they don't have to go have a meeting with somebody else, and then they get credit for it. There's a little bit of this, hey, I'm bringing this to you. You know, I don't want it to get lost in the shuffle of, as it goes up the line, then I'm not, the, you know, I want the credit.
I want the credit.
Look at me, look at me.
I want the credit, yeah. And so a lot of times what they'll do is when they see you outside your office, then they think you're fair game,
like,
right?
Like at Whole Foods. Like they when you're over there, you're looking for a canned ham.
Yeah.
And I'm like, hey, I know where all the canned hams are.
Organic?
Yeah, there's an organic canned ham over this way, and I just want you to know why you're over here.
Hey, I ran into you. I mean, I was at a concert the other day, and a former employee came up and kind of got me, and I was kind of caught. You know, I didn't have any, I couldn't do the rash. I couldn't do the Dr. John. It was a former employee.
You didn't have your mace on you.
I couldn't say bring that up in a meeting and everything.
Now, a dirty move you could have done if you had more skills in this area.
Yes.
I call it the wicked awesome faking injury. Now, all of a sudden, like, what you do is you're down. And you just run out crying.
No, I've done that before, but I didn't fake the injury before.
Oh, okay.
So what will happen is that, you know, there's certain zones in your business where you know you're going to the bathroom, you know you're going down the certain hallways, break rooms, you're gonna get a got a minute, you know, you're going to get a hey. And if you don't want that to happen right then, what I do a lot of the times, Clay, is like I said, I'll put up the phone to my ear.
That's a move.
This is horrible, isn't it?
No, it's a move, though.
Is it mean? Am I mean? And I'll pretend like I'm on a call, and then as I go by him, I can give him the nod.
Yeah, the
I can give him the wink. I can give him the thumb up. I can give him rattle my guns, and then just slide on by and get out my car and gone.
Well, another thing you can do in a big open office like this office, one thing you can do is you go, absolutely, I'll call you on the way out to no one in particular.
Yeah.
And then it's done.
And then it's done.
Done deal.
You just boogie. So I think that's what it is that, and I think a lot of it is people's heart is that they want to, maybe it's a good idea or a problem that needs to be solved, and they want that credit. So they try to get, they don't want to go to their,
which is why which is why you need to have a system in place. Like, hey, log all of your complaints here. Any issues you have, put them here. Turn it into this manager. But if people refuse to follow the system,
yeah,
you got to come up with these kind of tricky moves. Now, according to dictionary.com, a reputable website, the gauntlet was a formal, it was a specific, not so good form of punishment that the military would do. So if you got in trouble and you were just constantly causing problems and they were like, okay, we've talked about it for the fourth time, now it's time to run the gauntlet. And the gauntlet was literally, there'd be two rows of men and you had to run down the middle while they beat you. Hit you with switches, kicked you, and just made it tough.
Wow.
And that sounds like elementary school.
Yeah.
Is that not that's the...
Well, I'm just saying is that...
Sounds like my house growing up.
But that is kind of like what it's like in business sometimes. You're just trying to get to the office, and you already have 37 dramas, 14 missed calls, email complaints. I mean, I logged it the other day, Chup. I logged it because I wanted to bring it up for this show and just to kind of have a specific...
Is this about me personally, Clay?
No, I turned my phone off at 5, and then I woke up at 3:21, and I checked, and I had 226 missed interruptions. 226.
Wow.
From 5 p.m. to 3:21. And I don't ever check during the day, so I just decided to check just for fun for this exercise. So I had 7 missed calls, 2 Facebook friend requests, 6 Facebook messages, 27 Facebook notifications, 57 LinkedIn My Network notifications, 2 LinkedIn direct messages, 41 LinkedIn notifications, 2 voicemails, 14 text messages, 37 YouTube notifications, 31 Twitter notifications, equaling 226 potential interruptions. And that was before, I was just between 5 and 3:21 in the morning. And it was by 3:29 that I finished it, and I hit refresh, and there was more. And I'm like, I got to stop.
I got to stop.
This is why I don't go crazy. Here.
Yeah. This is a gauntlet.
Okay, so Chup, when you ran your own business, when you managed a construction crew, what were the typical distractions that bothered you then or that typically interrupt your clients now as a business coach?
What I, dealt with then and what I see happens now a lot is it's first thing in the morning, right? First thing in the morning, you're getting the day started. And typically, it has to do with the employee's lack of preparation. So they didn't pre-think, if they weren't being proactive, they didn't think of something the day or two before, and right now they got to have it now because the work day's about to start. We got guys out waiting.
I woke up this morning, and I ruined Chubb's head.
Exactly. My hair, but it's looking good today.
Oh, nice. No.
So one move that I've seen you do, Clay actually used to do this as well, is don't show up until to your workplace until like you have to. Like,
Carlton Pearson taught me that move.
Yes.
And you see me, I literally come in the minute of the meeting.
We have a 6 a.m. meeting. It's like 5:59 and 50 seconds. Doo, 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 doo,
because late, there's late. Always like someone that screws with your emotional state.
Always.
It's always somebody who's like, here's the deal. I can't be at this meeting. Is that okay?
First thing. First
and you're
thing.
Like, how can I even respond to that intelligently? The meeting's now. I don't know whether you need to be here or not. Who are you? Why are you asking me this? I mean, so that's a move. That's a move.
And here's the actual move, the under move. Of
ooh,
the move.
Under move.
It's to have like some sort of man cave or a home office that you can do your prep work, your meta time. You can get some stuff done from home before you have to get into
yeah.
the
now oh, you're preaching.
Do it.
Talking.
And that way you can kind of get your stuff done and you're not over here for an hour doing your meta time, doing whatever you need to do beforehand with people trying to do got a minutes on you. So now, get that office set up at home.
Now, Z, with the accoutrements that you have in your home office, obviously we're not going to take all the drivers to your home office, to your home. But I would like for you to talk about the accoutrements, the decor, the pageantry, the aura of your man cave slash office. Because you have a place where you get up in the morning, you kind of organize your thoughts, you plan at night. I want you to describe just the aura, the vibe, the atmosphere, the legacy, the tradition, Z. What kind of stuff, what kind of swag do you have in this room that allows you to plan your day strategically in a way that allows you to get so much more done? Because there's got to be some piece of swagaliciousness.
Leather-bound
some piece
books.
Of leather-bound books. There's certainly something in that room that
rich,
gives you...
rich leather-bound books cascading down the walls. No, I have a full office set up there at, you know, at my pad, and it's got all the, you know, bells and whistles I need to make things happen. It's got phones.
I'm not letting you off that
computers,
easy.
Computers.
No, I'm not letting you off that. I want to hear. I want you to line item
scanner.
List. This is a stone
fax
cold
machine.
Lead pipe guarantee. Z's gonna break down the stuff he has in that room, and I'm not gonna let him get off with a weak sauce
massage
vague
chair.
Answer.
Oh yeah, it's got a you know zebra rug.
Z.
That I like to lay on in the morning and kind of think about my day.
Stay tuned. It's the Thrive Time Show on your radio. And do not think about that during the break. Business coach.
Although time may take us into different places, I will still be patient with you. And I hope you know I won't let go. I'll be your lifeline tonight. I won't let go. I'll be your.
All right, Thrive Nation, we're talking about the art of getting things done, and specifically, how do you, in a busy world filled with many, many distractions, how do top-level entrepreneurs get more stuff done than the average person? We've broken it down into the 66 moves. Each one of these moves could save you copious amounts of time. And the last move we just covered was you want to avoid those got-a-minute meetings. And Eric Chupp, a business coach, brought up, and you do that well by planning out your day before you get to the office, which leads us to the question of, well, what does your home office look like? I mean, what kind of swagaliciousness do you have there? So I'm going to start with myself. And I'm going to list off some of the things I have there that I believe to be necessities that allow me to work from home.
Okay.
And when I get to the end of that list, it will be hour three, which we only have a two-hour show. So, but here we go. One is I like to have a computer with three monitors and a backup computer with three monitors.
He does have those things.
For a total of six monitors and two computers.
That sounds very necessary.
With a couple laptops mixed in the mix, too.
No. Yeah, no, so I have two. Then I like to have a printer with all the backup ink,
uh-huh.
And I like to have, this is just stuff I have, then I have a scanner, right? Then I've got mouse, and I have backup mice hung up on mice.
Multi-mice.
I do.
Do you have like a mice family?
Yeah. I have three.
Oh, okay.
And then I have power cords, and then backup. You've seen it. I have all the attachments, anything you would need. It's like a guitar center.
There's maybe 100 cords hanging on the wall.
Probably.
It feels like the Apple Store.
Yeah, they're all, anything you need there. And then I have backups for everything. And when I go to work, I mean, just this Sunday, I was working on editing the book from 3 a.m. till about 9, working on editing a book called The Art of Getting Things Done. We're going to give to all of our business coach clients, which is what we're covering here. And I'm tightening up all the research and the stats and getting ready to go. And, you know, this is kind of, this is stupid, and this just lets you into the psychosis that is my life. My printer runs out of ink, and I smiled. I remember that. I'm like, oh, yeah.
Oh, I got you.
I love myself.
I got you.
And I just
good
got,
try.
And I
good
just
try.
Got the other ink, and I'm like, this is awesome.
This
tried to get me printer, but I'm not going to let
but
you
then
today.
A couple weeks ago, I'm working on something, and you know how, like, sometimes you get clever and you maybe you spill. If you're me, you spill more often than not, you know. And, yeah. I did a little spill action, and I spilled, and I have paper in the office. And I was like, I've got backup paper.
I've got backups on my backups.
Yeah, and then I have a little running list, and I just refill it all the time. So I never am running out of stuff.
And he also has a huge bowl of paper clips. I know how much.
I actually banned paper clips from the man cave. And I have tons of highlighters, backup highlighters. I got colored pencils. I just have it all there. And I can get everything done, and I can survive. I have a pinion wood, backup pinion wood. Chup, you've seen the backup pinion wood.
I've burned from the backup pinion wood. We've run out and opened up the backup.
And have you seen my insane collection of socks?
I've heard. I have not seen the glory, but I've heard.
Yeah. So anyway, the point is, I really never have to leave the man cave. But I say that because I used to have an office with very minimal supplies, minimal equipment, and my computer would crash. And I'm like, frick, I got to go back to the office. And I don't have anybody else. Or printer wouldn't print. And so now it's all redundant. It's backed up. I basically have built a space shuttle in my man cave, see.
Yeah, that's impressive. I'm just embarrassed now. I have one laptop. I have one printer / scan fax machine thing.
This guy.
Yeah, and you know, I just feel very under ready.
Well, you have about the same amount of laptops that Benjamin Franklin had in his man cave.
Just about.
Yeah, you get the same number. Yeah, just one more.
Yeah, just about. I mean, if Y2K hits again, I mean, I'm not prepared. Like, you are prepared.
I could shoot off a
disaster
missile
that could befall you.
Well, with budget cuts, the military called me and they said, "Hey, listen, we're trying to shut down some of these silos, you know, in the in the Midwest, you know, in Colorado, we're going to shut it down, you know.
We hear
would you be willing
screens.
To be a launch center?" And I said, "Absolutely,
absolutely."
No, we hear you have six screens.
Yeah, yeah.
You know, so Star Trek called the new Star Trek producer guy.
Oh,
he's we're
going
to make a new one, and you know, we're having some budget cuts. Can we just shoot the show here? You know,
in your man cave.
You know, I'm like, hey, no problem. I mean, I have no problem with Sulu. I like him. I like Spock. I like all the people you've chosen.
I like Spock too.
Uhura.
He seems like a real steady
Scotty.
Dude. You know.
Yeah, I just have a guy in the back of the back of the man cave just yelling that
very
he can't
logical.
Give us the power.
Yeah. Yeah. Just,
okay.
Yeah. So we're trying
I can't
to
give you the power. You
I
know?
Can't.
Okay. Now we're moving on to move number 53. Pay people to do what they do best, so you don't end up spending your entire day fixing your computer, cleaning your house, doing your laundry, and mowing your lawn. Here's a notable quotable. From Tim Ferriss. When I read this the first time, I thought, oh my gosh, what am I doing? This was huge. This was huge information for me about 12 years ago. I just thought this was powerful. He says, if you spend your time worth 20 to 25 an hour doing something that someone else would do for $10 an hour, it's simply a poor use of resources. So I'm just asking you rhetorically, Thrive Nation, what are you doing that you could pay someone else to do that would free up your time? So see, are there any little life hacks out there, little things that you pay a little bit for, but it frees up your time? Maybe a little valet over here, a little Uber over there, maybe a little laundry pickup over here, maybe
All those things. I
what
mean,
do you,
you
do?
Know, housekeeper, for instance.
You have a housekeeper?
Housekeeper, you know, come in and clean.
This guy's a diva.
He's out of control. He's
You have a housekeeper, Z?
Yeah, laundry service, but I do some laundry, you know, some of my more intimate things.
Ooh,
I wash myself.
Let's spend the next 4 hours talking about that.
No, let's not.
Okay.
4 a.m. Let's talk about that at 4 a.m.
Yeah, but you know, I mean, landscaping, I mean, all that kind of stuff. I mean, yeah, you get to that, and that's what's so fun about being successful is that you can have that financial freedom and time freedom to then have that stuff to where you're not out mowing the yard, pulling weeds, or planting flowers, or whatever it is.
Fun
if you like
factoid.
Doing that, if you like doing that, it's
fun
cool.
factoid pulled from my cranium in Larry Bird's book called Drive. Mm-hmm. It's his autobiography. It's hysterical. He moves from French Lick, Indiana, to Boston, and no one really knows who he is until his senior year of college. You know, and he had a rough upbringing. Long story short, his father committed suicide. He dropped out of the game of basketball. He was recruited by Bob Knight to play at Indiana. He quits the team, has a baby, gets married, gets divorced, all while he's a freshman.
Yeah.
So as a sophomore, he shows up, just a goofy guy, and he starts dominating at Indiana State. They end up putting up an unbelievable season. They actually go into the finals, and the Celtics draft this guy. Well, he's on the Celtics, and he said he'd never been to the cities outside of traveling for basketball tournaments. He'd just never been on a plane, never went anywhere. So he thought, you know, one thing that he always did for fun back in Indiana, in French Lick, which is a super small town, he called himself the Hick from French Lick, by the way. The Hick from French Lick. He said,
I like that.
He said, I found it therapeutic to mow my lawn. So he bought a house right there by Boston Gardens because he thought that it made sense, you know, save the commute just to be able to jog to the game or, you know, drive.
Sure. Yeah, yeah.
So he gets a lawnmower and he's mowing his lawn. And his wife, his second wife, is like, you know, Larry, people are going to, don't do it. You're 6'10". No one looks like you. Just stop mowing the lawn. He's like, no, this is my thing. So he said that he's mowing the lawn. He's pigheaded because he's committed. He's a very driven guy. He's mowing the lawn. And he says he's hearing a fan like, hey, Larry. And he's like, hey, what's up, man? And then pretty soon there's like 10 people. Hey, Larry.
Larry.
And he's like, he's turning each corner. And they're like, oh, yes.
Oh, yeah.
And so he's like edging. Yeah. He says he's edging. And there's like hundreds of people being
from
like,
from downtown.
And then people are like, can I edge for you? So he's like, he's handing them like his weed eater. And he's handing them the mower. And there's like a volunteer crowd of Celtics fans. They're cheering and chanting. And then people found out he lived there. So he says, you know, he goes to bed. And people drive by like, get him tomorrow, Tiger. Go get him. They're honking their horn. And he's like, he couldn't sleep because everyone's honking. So long story short, Larry Bird said that he didn't want to ever delegate mowing the lawn because he liked it. But he kind of had to because of just the celebrity status. But I think if you're listening to this show right now, you might therapy. I mean this sincerely. You might enjoy just doing your laundry. You know, you might be somebody who enjoys mowing the lawn. But you have to ask yourself if your core task as a leader, which really is just getting stuff done. If you're not able to get your job done, but you're out there at Target shopping around for a Halloween costume, you got some problems. And see, I see this a lot where you have top leaders that are, you know, there's small level or small businesses trying to get bigger, and they're not getting their core tasks done. So your managers are waiting on you. People are, you know, you're holding up the line, and you're like, well, I couldn't get it done because I was mowing my lawn.
You know, a little side note.
Yeah.
My ranch, you know, out south of town?
Yeah.
The Rockin' Z Ranch?
Rockin'!
I like to go out there sometimes and mow.
Do you really?
Yeah, I just put my headset on and...
You listen to Aerosmith while you're mowing?
No, not typically.
Really?
Well, I mean, you know, I mean, who doesn't like a good little Aerosmith every now and then?
You should listen to that. I mean, it's...
But, you know, I just feel like I'm out there just mowing, you know, and just a day, just mind blank and just listen to music and mowing.
Breathing in the nature.
I think I could see you mowing while listening to Walk This Way.
What about mow this way?
Yes. Yeah. Mow this way. That's a mow this way. Ow.
Now give me a trim.
Mow this way. Now but give me a trim.
But I've never had the problem where people will stop on the highway and get out and honk and wave at me and offer to do it for me. I've never had the Larry Bird situation happen to me. Well, just side note, sidebar.
Yes, little sidebar segue. And we come back, we're gonna talk about the next move to get more stuff done. The art of getting things done. Move number 54. What is it? Z, what is move number 54? What is the move?
Sounds top secret.
Tell me the move. Z, tell me the move.
When we come back from the break, I'll tell you the move.
See, this isn't just a clever radio trick to get people to stay.
No, he really doesn't know the move.
When we come back, I'll tell you the move.
Z, give me the move.
We're running out of time. I can't tell it right now.
Z, if you just, you got 5 or 6 seconds, you could give me the move.
When we get back.
Stay tuned. I'm a business coach.
It's business school without the BS. Welcome to the Thrive Time Show on Talk Radio 1170.
Oh, yeah, Thrive Nation. Put those hands in the air. Wave around like you just don't care. But keep one hand on the... Have someone else just hold the wheel for you.
Use your knee. Do something.
Use your knee. Pull over. No texting and driving. But dancing and driving is totally acceptable in Oklahoma.
Legal.
All right, now, Thrive Nation, we're talking about the art of getting things done. It really is an art. I mean, it really is. You got to learn this craft. You got to figure it out over time. And move 54, this is a move that I want to make sure I adequately share this move and that you understand this move, because this is a move that really is about delaying gratification. It's really about...
Oh, come on now.
So don't travel. Move 54. Don't travel until you are not perpetually behind. Now work with me. I know people who are real estate agents, photographers, dentists, lawyers, people that I've worked with intimately, good people, who are always, I say, how are you? Oh my gosh, I'm just trying to get caught up. I'm always behind. And you say, well, what's going on? They say, I went to Miami. I said, you went to Miami? It's great. You know, well, I got behind, you know. And then they come back and I'm like, well, you know, can I help you? Do you need any help? No, I got to head out this weekend to Denver. This weekend, okay. And they're always behind, and so they haven't earned the right yet to travel, in my opinion, consistently, but yet they can afford to travel. Financially, they can afford to, but their organization is crumbling under the lack of leadership. You know what I'm saying? It's like a leadership vacuum.
Yeah, yeah.
They leave, and it creates this weird effect. You know, when we toppled Saddam Hussein, a lot of people said there's going to be a vacuum effect. When you take a dictator out of a country who's controlling it through force, you take him out, all of a sudden, all these terrorist tribes are going to be merged, and someone has to take over. I mean, someone's going to. And I see this all the time in business where the leader is absent. Not even on, like, a big exotic trip, Z. They're just gone all the time. They're not there. And, again, I have no problem with you leaving if you can keep things in order while you're gone. But, Z, talk to me about the absent leader who has chaos as the norm.
Yeah, and there's two distinctions there. One is traveling for business, and one is traveling for fun.
Business.
And your business. It's business time. And I'll tell you what, delaying gratification is kind of the takeaway with that. And I think that's such a huge component of successful entrepreneurship. Because what happened a lot of times is that people, you know, Clay, we hate this number.
We hate it.
I hate this number.
We don't like the number.
I'm going to say it, but 80% of businesses that open up fail.
80% of businesses are shutting the doors.
And that's no good.
It's too high.
And so I think one of the reasons some of those businesses are shutting down is because the owner is not delaying the gratification. They are going, like you said, going on trips that they shouldn't be going on. They are not taking care of. Because here's one of the core things I taught my children.
The core moves.
One of the core moves. And if you sat down with any of my three children, you said, what's one of the things your dad kind of just pounded home? Right?
You'd have to visit him at a local penitentiary. But if you were to get in there for visitation.
If you could get in through the guards, three kids that are over there, sign 12 times, and I make sure you take your ID.
They're McAllister, right?
Yeah. Well,
they're all together.
Well, they were, but one had to go to a...
No, in all sincerity, great kids, awesome kids, all great. And I mean this sincerely because one of the things I look at when you judge a character of a guy, I mean this sincerely, is you look at the kids and you say, you know, what are they doing? What do they learn? What did dad teach them? And I mean that sincerely. Yeah. You meet the kids, awesome people, and Bridget's helping you run the op. She's actually an optometrist now for you. Uh-huh.
Blake's an optometry school. Bo is doing his real estate appraisal thing. So just not like, a lot of success.
So it's not like your kids are living under a bridge and then you're asking them these tips.
Right.
Just give a little back.
Can I say something real quick? As we're going over this, Aubrey, Clay's son, is mopping the office.
Oh, yeah.
He's mopping the office right behind us.
Child labor laws.
Well,
probably
I mean,
Metaphorically mopping. You did just turn off the, radio show right now.
Back to you, Z.
But one thing I would tell them all the time is, no. We work first, then play.
Work first, then play.
Work first, then play.
Stop Leon Letting.
And that's exactly what number 54 is talking about. People that go, you know, I've done a little bit of work this week, now I'm going to go play. And I'm going to leave my work alone, and my work's going to get behind. I'm going to go play.
I'm going to whack a golf ball. I'm behind, and I'm not going to make my payroll.
All the time. So that's probably some core advice. If you're listening out there and you want to start a business, we know 57%, according to Forbes, if you're listening right now, are going, you know, I'm thinking about starting
57% of people, according to Forbes, want to start their own business. Here's a remarkable stat for you. Do you know in the last 20 years in American history, over 65% of all the jobs that have been created have been created by small business owners?
There you go.
And you know that there's companies out there. I mean, think about this. There's somebody listening right now, and you're going to catch this spark. But Elon Musk, first-generation wealth. Walt Disney, first-generation wealth. Think about, like, Steve Jobs, first-generation wealth. Think about Oprah, first-generation wealth. Think about Jeff Bezos, first-generation. You think about all of the people who are first-generation. According to a book called The Millionaire Next Door, over 80% of the world's millionaires are first-generation.
And they're working first and playing later.
That's it. So move 55 now. You want to live a purposeful life by clearly knowing your goals and putting them into your schedule. Now, this is what's crazy.
What?
Tim Ferriss wrote the book, The 4-Hour Work Week. He's also an angel investor in Facebook. It's Facebook. You ever heard of Facebook?
It didn't sound like it's going to amount to anything.
Twitter?
What?
Evernote?
What?
Uber? Uber? It's Uber. Never heard of it. Okay. Yeah. He says, for all their complaining about what's holding them back, most people have a lot of trouble coming up with the defined dreams that they're being held from. Whoa. Z says, for all their complaining about what's holding them back, most people have a lot of trouble coming up with defined dreams that they're being held back from. I want freedom. Well, what would you do with your freedom? I don't know. So it's super important that you take a moment right now to define your F6 life.
Oh, wait a second. Did you just say freedom?
Freedom!
But they'll never take our freedom!
Yes! I thought you were going to play some George Michael.
I am. Pace yourself, freedom. Young grasshopper.
Spoiler alert.
I know. My goodness.
Freedom. You got to give. That song is great.
Yeah. Yeah.
You remember that song, Freedom?
I love it.
That song gets me going. Now, that was about him. That was about him making a certain announcement, that song, by the way.
Oh.
He was letting people know. He's like, you know what? I'm coming out of a certain, you know, area of my life. George Michael, may he rest in peace.
There you go.
It's sad. It's sad the way he died. But I will tell you, George, we like several of your songs.
Yeah, I mean, how could you not?
How could you not like Faith?
Yeah.
Now, wouldn't it be nice if I could touch your body? You know, that song is great.
Great song.
Now, I encourage you right now, one, go get George Michael's greatest hits on Spotify. Listen to them until your brain explodes. But then two, write down your F6 goals. What are your goals in the following six areas? What are your goals for your faith? How can you have goals for your faith? Well, okay, as an example, do you want to attend church weekly? Do you not? Do you want to go to some meditative camp? Tim Ferriss, the author of the 4-Hour Work Week, he attends a 10-day silent retreat that apparently multiple billionaires go to this thing. And I'm like, 10 days?
That'd be hard
silent?
For you.
He loves going to that.
Could you be 10 days and not talk?
Yeah, I mean, I in the man cave, I don't really talk at all the entire time I'm down there. I listen to a lot of stuff, though.
Yeah.
I listen to a lot of audiobooks, man.
Yeah.
Man.
It's awesome.
It's awesome.
Yeah.
I mean, you'd think you could go 10 days without talking.
To other people, I think I couldn't go without talking to myself because I enjoy the conversations.
That's a different issue. That's the whole thing.
Number two, what are your specific one-year goals for your family? You know, do you want to make the family bigger? Do you want to move the family? Do you want to get a new job? See, very few people are intentional about their family. They're just, hey, why do you live in Tulsa? Well, I always have.
Date nights, get that scheduled in. I mean, building, you know, I mean, time with your kids. Do you have a time that you take one-on-one with each of your kids? I mean, yeah, you have to be very purposeful in that. And it pays off big dividends. I tell you what, if you're, you know, one of the things you find with busy entrepreneurs is that they're busy. And then the family sometimes gets a little bit left behind, and they will fuss on occasion. You got to listen to that.
As your unadopted son, as a guy who just basically shows up and just borrows things, you know, it's kind of like the guy who borrows enough things and stays there enough that he just sort of adopts himself. You know?
Sure. Oh yeah. Yeah.
As a member of your family on the outside, I want to point out your wardrobe is changing, and I'm tired of it. And there has to be a stop.
I need to get back to soccer jerseys. I'm sorry.
I don't even know you anymore.
And who are you?
I don't have a lot of long-sleeve soccer jerseys. I need to get some more long-sleeve soccer jerseys.
I'm going
to
make you turn in your man card for even observing the weather. A real man would just go out there, cold or hot, wear the same thing.
I know. Remember the other day, I come in freezing outside. I got on shorts and flip-flops and a T-shirt.
You were prepared for the weather today, and I'm offended. So we'll have to have a family meeting about this. Okay.
Okay. Well, I'm sorry. I'm sorry for the offense.
Talk to John.
Talk to John about that, I'm going to show you a rash.
All right. Now, the next, you want to set your goals for your friendships. Now, this is huge. The people you know will determine the direction that you grow. Z, the people that you know will determine the direction that you grow. How does that work?
Well, your net work is your net worth. You surround yourself with wealthy, smart people. It's going to be better than surrounding yourself with idiots.
Idiots.
You know?
See, tell me, how do you do this? How do you, because you have been very intentional about surrounding yourself with really high quality, high character people, while also staying in touch with, you know, people you grew up with, people you were, you know, you're just kind of, there's people in your life that you couldn't choose. And there's people in your life you could choose. And you've done a really good job of being purposeful about who you choose to spend your time with while still, you know, maintaining the roots. How do you do it, Z?
Since it's kind of a button strong day.
Oh, you hit the button.
I'm gonna come and do a little. Ha! It's been a while since I preached.
Ha! Preach it.
You see here, folks.
Go ahead.
Sometimes you have to take a good look around.
Mm-hmm.
And you got to say to yourself, who am I surrounded by?
Mm-hmm.
Mm-hmm.
Amen.
Mm-hmm. Come on now. Whoa. Come on now.
Preach it.
And if you're looking around you, you say, that's an idiot. That's an idiot.
Preach it.
And that's an idiot.
Preach it.
You know what?
You might just
be an idiot too.
That's just repaying you.
Come on now.
Bring it.
So what you need to do? Seriously, folks, if your core inner circle are people that are not doing well in life, they have a tendency, if you run with the dogs, you're going to get fleas.
Can I give you an example of this?
Oh, yeah, please do.
And it's far enough in the past that the person who I'm talking about won't be able to guess, but I see this person for Thanksgiving, and I said, how are you? you know, how are you?
Yeah, how you doing?
Gosh, you know, the economy is down. Now, just so we're clear, the economy's been very good for the last 4 years, okay? But the economy's just down, you know, can't find a job. Now, I don't even ask, like, have you applied? But it's like the economy's just down. It's down, and I just... And then they basically mentally are scanning for anyone they know who has an illness, and they're like, yeah, and such has really bad measles. Bad bumps, bad rash. And you're just listening, like, my ankle hurts, her ankle hurts, my foot hurts, their foot. And you just, they're like, you're listening. Like, no, I'm not kidding. It was like a 30-minute just listing of ailments and injuries.
Oh,
and then I painful. Said, well, hey, let's watch the game. And it's like, all those people get overpaid, don't you think? And then they sit there on the couch and say, can you turn it down? I'm trying to read a book. And they're sitting there reading a book
while
everyone else is trying to watch. I'm not kidding. They're sitting there on the couch going, could you guys turn it down? And they're annoyed that other people are talking because they're trying to read this book.
Yeah. Oh, yeah.
And I'm going, this is Thanksgiving. We got to bring the energy. And they're like, no, if you could just turn it down. And by the way, your Hummer, could you move it? Could you move the
I'd
Hummer?
Be
it's in the front.
That.
And I think it blocks the front. And I just want to move. And I'm just like, oh my gosh. And this is the thing is, for me, Thanksgiving has always been a downer because I can't choose who I'm around.
Yeah.
So what I do, this is my move. I'll say, do you need more butter? And if someone will go, yeah, I guess. I'm like, I'll go get it at the store. And I look for the last store that's open, always a QT or something that's open on Thanksgiving. And I make as many random
butter runs?
Runs for anything. It's
anything.
Like, yeah, they're like, hey, Mike, can you give me an extra fork? Yeah, at the store. I mean, well, I'm just telling you, you literally cannot be around negative people or they're going to drag you down.
You down to Funky Town.
It's not going
to
be good. When we come back, we're talking more about living a purposeful life and specifically defining your F6 goals. It's so important that you do this. If you don't do it, you're going to lose. You're going to lose. You got to be intentional because I'm telling you, nobody cares about your success more than you. I would even argue no one even cares about your success as much as you or half as much as you. They might put you on the prayer list, put you on the refrigerator, but they're not praying for you every day.
True.
They're not going to call you every day. They're going to encourage you every morning. You got to encourage yourself.
You got to fire yourself up. I love the fact that you said you could go 10 days and not talk to somebody else, but you couldn't go 10 days and not talk to yourself.
Absolutely. The conversations are enriching. They're purposeful. They're uplifting. They're kind of funny sometimes.
You got to like yourself.
Yeah, absolutely.
Broadcasting live from the center of the universe, the Business Coach Radio Show, not endorsed by Richard Roberts.
You may be discouraged and feel like giving in. You may feel that you're a mess and that you'll never win.
Everybody
well,
now,
that's a lie of the devil. He'll try to keep you down. Just turn.
I don't understand why Dick Robb's musical career didn't take off. I mean, that was a hot track.
Hot sauce.
You may be discouraged, hey, or feel like giving in. Hey. Now, see, you were going to give us an uplifting joke during the commercial break, and I said, no, that joke you gave us was too. You gave us the joke, and I'm like, that gift.
It's too big.
It was too big. It was too humble. It was too awesome to not share with the listeners. Can you share the joke?
Because Butterchef was talking about hooves.
Yeah, hooves. Yeah.
And I said, well, you know why cows have hooves?
And I said, well, why do they have hooves?
They lactose.
wait, because of the milk?
Oh, you're smart. Oh, Chef's smart.
Wait. Oh, toes. I get it.
These young kids.
Now, move 55. Move 55. We're talking about living a purposeful life by knowing your goals. Next goal, you have the F6 life, the next goal we're talking about. We talked about faith, family, friendship. Now, fitness. Now, this is one that is kind of, it's near and dear to my heart. I want to talk about it. Fitness. Whenever, like, if I'm the kind of guy that, like, if I can just get it in my calendar, it'll happen. So, like, right now, you know, I work out 4 days a week, and I'm getting back into a flow. And I set my own goals, you know? So I'm making progress. I feel good about it. But other people are going to want to set your goals. So other people, like your trainer, I have a great trainer who listens to me. But in the past, I've had trainers who are like, hey, man, you're making good gains, bro. Bro, you're making good gains.
Bro.
Bro.
You're bro-rific.
Bro, there's an amateur competition like on the 3rd of like March. We could do this.
Taekwondo.
And I'm going, no.
No.
I don't want to do that. What I'm trying to do is just get to about 200 pounds and stay there. You know what I mean? I just
not
I don't,
die.
That's yeah. And they're like, bro, but like, dude, your striations are starting to really. Now, if you want to get ripped faster, we got this new ripped fuel you can take, and it helps you, like, increases your vascularity. And I'm like, so that I look like I'm flexing?
Yeah.
That's okay.
But you didn't get the rip fuel?
But they have these moves they do. They'll say, bro, if you could just get, like, a bike and you could ride that. I'm like, no, I already work 5 hours. I already work out, you know, 5 hours a week. I don't want to go home and ride a bike for another 2 hours. So I'm just telling you, no matter what your goals are for faith, there's always somebody who wants to take you on another missions trip, whether you want to go or not. You know, they feel like that because they're called, now you're called. Right?
Sure.
And for fitness, because they're into running, now you have to go running.
Right.
So you're a guy who likes to stay in shape.
Yeah.
But there's got to have been at least 45 5Ks that you've said no to in the last 25 years. At least 45 5Ks. People look at you, they go, this guy looks to be in shape. He looks like he's beyond just a shape. He looks to be in shape.
Chiseled.
So why don't – he's got good calves.
You could sponsor it and run in it.
So that's what they'll do. They'll look at your calves. They'll go, he's got good calves.
Are you talking about my calves?
He advertises.
Again?
He's got good – it's just good leg muscles, really, Margaret. But anyway, so what they'll do is they'll walk up to you and they'll say, so we have this fun run we're doing and we're looking for a sponsor.
It's fun. It's fun run.
And we could call
running
it,
is
oxymoron.
We could call it 2020 because there's Vision 2020 and you're an optometrist and there's a fun run and you've got good calves.
20
and
miles.
It'll be and if 20.2 miles.
Yeah. And if you
it'll be for fun.
If you put in $20,020, that would just be, what do you think? And so talk to me, because people do put fitness goals on you, do they not?
Oh, of course they do. You know, everybody, and a lot of it's your friends and people around you, they want you to go and do whatever fitness thing they're doing. And, you know, and so.
Iron Man.
You know, hey, a triathlon. If you're not doing a triathlon, you're not a real man.
It's the mud runner. Run in the mud. Awesome.
You know, my brothers, I've got a couple brothers that are very active, and so they're always kind of like, you know, hey,
UFC.
Come to this run. Hey, do this. You know, hey, do that. In fact, little known factoid. My brother, Chuck, who's a chiropractor here in Tulsa, Oklahoma.
He'll crack your back.
Charles Zoellner. We call him Chuck. He was on the front page of the Tulsa World a day or two ago with, you know, they have the Tulsa Run.
Oh.
And he ran as the Stay Puff Marshmallow Man.
Really?
And that was him on the picture on the front of the Tulsa World.
Hey, I want to ask you a serious question. You know, ESPN has their body issue.
Yeah.
Was this the body issue of the Tulsa World?
It could have been.
Was it kind of a naughty issue? Like, the body issue? And Chuck was on the cover?
And his wife, Shara Kimiko, who's an on-air personality.
Now I get respectful.
Scripts, Channel 2.
Yeah, cheers.
She was like the little, she was right next to him you know, the one that slimed in the movie Ghostbusters, the little monster guy. Yeah, she was in her outfit. It was so cute. She was dressed as that, and they were running the Tulsa Run together. It's a little known fact.
Just Google that, Matt.
So my brother would have loved for me to have dressed up in a costume, probably a Ghostbuster outfit.
With something weird.
Yeah.
And it don't look good.
And run the Tulsa Run with him. But
who
I was like,
call?
You know, he's gotten to the point now where he doesn't even ask because he knows I'm just going to say no.
The next move, now that we've shut it down, is...
Oh, I'm bringing it back. You know
what are the specific one-year goals for your finances? Now, this is one I want you to hold court here, because everybody wants to give you financial goals. They love to say, hey, Clay, you know, why don't you give to this? Or, hey, why don't you do this? Or, why don't you invest in that? Or, why don't you... And the thing is, there's nothing wrong with making a profit. To quote R. Kelly, I don't see nothing wrong... with a little, and then I change the rest of the quote. But I don't see nothing wrong with a little bit of, you know, profit.
Yeah, making some money. I mean, that's what we're about.
Making the money.
We're about number one, keeping the doors open. Then number two, making some money while you're doing it, because that leads to the lifestyle that you want. You know, that you want. And a lot of times, when people ask me about financial stuff, is I'll work backwards on them. I'll say, well, when do you want to retire? You know, when do you want to...
I love to work all the time. I love to work all the time. It's what I do.
Like what I say with my financial planner, you know, we kind of start at the end and work our way back. And then that gives me the goals every year to hit to make that goal. You don't want to retire with this much money in the bank. Then you want to retire when? So now it's a math formula. And then you kind of work backwards. And you know how much you're needing to save. You know how much you're needing to make, you know. And that's, you know, that was a question that was asked in the last workshop that we did when the guy stood up and said, how much money should I pay myself? Okay, I'm starting off. You know, as an entrepreneur, I own the business. How much I pay myself?
I don't want anybody else. When I think about myself, how much should I pay myself?
You're really doing a bunch of throwback.
Anybody else? Oh no.
80s.
Oh no.
Make your own lyrics up songs today. I like that.
The thing is that was a disturbing song, and DeVillis sang it, and I know this because I was a DJ. So I just want to bring that up. That I don't want anybody else, but I just want to know how much should I pay myself.
Is there a song trapped in your brain? Because we know you have a very large head, a very large, and I'm assuming a large brain to go with the massive cranium you have.
It's a huge wig.
Is there a song in there that you wish was not in there?
Madness by the Muse is a great song right now that I can't get out of my cranium. It's just really good.
No, I'm taking it like a bad, like a song that you're like, oh, that's like the world's worst song, and I listened to it, and I wish I hadn't.
Some
like
girls
that.
Like to buy new shoes, and you know, that whole like, it's like the girls just want to have fun.
Oh,
girls
yeah.
just want to have
oh,
fun.
Gosh. I almost
wedding.
Forgot that song.
Every wedding. Is there, oh, my gosh.
Thanks. Now it's going to be stuck
oh,
in my head.
Oh, my gosh.
I know. All day.
Here's the deal. I know you guys don't normally take requests, but we have a bunch of girls here, and we love this song.
Can and we just want to have fun.
And then the other song that makes me the worst, that makes me crazy is Wishing. And hoping and praying. And that song, it's just like, stop. And they always choreograph a dance that no one wants to watch, but we have to watch because they're in the wedding party.
Oh, yeah.
You know what I'm saying?
Oh, yeah. Oh, yeah.
And that's when I just like, I have a rash. Can I show it?
I have a rash. Can we do that?
I got a phone call coming in. Our babysitter's calling.
Excuse me, bride's father. I've got a rash that I need to go.
I've got a home camera that I can see from my phone, and it looks like there's an invasion. Oh, no. I mean, that's when I want to leave. Now, Thrive Nation, we come back. We're talking more about living a purposeful life and knowing your F6 goals. It's so important to know those F6 goals. Your goals for your faith, family, friendships, fitness, finances, and fun. Stay tuned. It's the Thrive Time Show on your radio. My name is Clay Clark. I am a business coach, and you have the capacity and the tenacity to be successful. Well, come on, Thrive Nation. You know you want to get into it. You know you want to. Here we go. Get out those quad skates. Here we go. Couples only. Couples only. Blacklight dance. We got a special on pickles. Dill pickles on sale right now. 2 candy bars for $1. Holler. Yes. Big shout out to anybody who just went to Roller City. I don't even know if Roller City is still open, but if you just went there to pay your respects to the place that once was the greatest place in Broken Arrow history, Roller City.
Gray shirt. Get your root beer off the floor there.
Do you remember? And they would give you those necklaces, Z? And when you could take the necklaces and you would break it, and it would unleash
glow.
The glow.
The glow, of course.
How is it possible?
It's magic.
I would spend weeks asking why. How is it possible? I'd go to sleep. I'd wake up and I realized it's not glowing anymore, and I realized the magic was gone.
This is how my mind works. I'm like, how did they ship those without them breaking?
Oh my! How do they do it? I mean, these are the big questions. These are the people. There's people who study theology,
not
theologians.
Me.
Yeah, yeah.
They study history, historians. I studied Roller City. And that's how I've got to where
roller
I am.
City.
Wow.
That's my trap door to the bottom.
Wow.
You want to go to the bottom, you just go right down that rabbit trail.
Keep roller skating.
All right, so here we go now. We're talking about living a purposeful life and specifically knowing your F6 goals. Now, you have to know the final goal, Z, you have to have your goals for fun. Now, I recommend all these goals, you break them into one-year goals. And the reason why I say that is because I don't know, you don't know, we don't know how long we're going to be alive, period. We've
period.
All lost some really, really good friends. All of a sudden, we're Prince. Purple rain. All of a sudden, gone.
Gone.
You know, Michael Jackson, you know, we're like, man, he's coming back. This is it tour. Gone.
I didn't get to see him in concert. It's the one guy I really wanted to see before he passed. And I was excited about his last concert. His tour he's going to do, and I'm going to go to it. And then
I was seriously listening to some George Michael. And then, like, the next morning, Gonzo.
Is it your fault?
Uh-oh.
And I just, people, eventually, we all die, and we don't know the day. I mean, if you, see, it's profound if you're above the ground.
It is.
So and you have
so
to.
So you have to make plans to have some fun.
So what are your plans to have some fun this year, my man? What are your plans? I mean, what kind of plans do you put on the list now where you say, that's going
to
happen?
When I get done with the show, I'm heading to the airport, I'm flying to San Diego, and I'm going to go to the Breeders' Cup this weekend. How
really?
About that?
San Diego.
Really?
San Diego, which
really?
Means.
Beep.
yeah, so I'm going to go. That's one thing I'm going to do for fun because I love horse racing. You know, I have race horses, and so I enjoy the sport. I'm going to go with some buddies. We got a house on the beach.
House
yes.
on the beach?
Yes. On the beach, kind of like our beach here, you know, Arkansas River with all the sand.
Well, our beach is nicer.
We're kind of on the, yeah, we're kind of like we're, it's almost like the ocean, except there's no water.
Now, see, San Diego also happens to be the site right now where the border wall prototypes are being set up. They're being assimilated.
I can go check those
are
out.
Are you actually going to the border to demonstrate your new wall design? Because, I mean, there's some spectacular designs out there.
I can't talk about that right now. I can't. That's a...
Not that you endorse the wall, but you're a capitalist. And
I can't talk about that right now. You did... I will say you are closer than not on that.
Which reminds me of Move 56, don't engage in gossip. Now, we talked about it a little bit on the other show. But you don't want to engage in gossip because what will happen is you'll get sucked in. And if you are somebody who is sincere, the best thing you can say is, you know what? They're not here, so I'm not going to talk about them. Now, the only thing is in business, and this is where I wrote this up for the show because I wanted to tee it up for you, Z, is if possible, you don't want to talk about people when they're not present. However, sometimes this is hard to do because when you're in charge of employees, and let's say that somebody's being nefarious, playing games, doing stuff, and you've got to find, you know, you got to get your elite team together, and the team is maybe you and your wife or you and your partner or whatever. Sometimes you got to gather all the facts, you know, before you act, and you've got to figure out what's going on. So I would just say 99% of the time, if the person who is being discussed is not there, don't engage in that conversation. However, I understand that there's no need for the United States of America to go tell the terrorists our next action in advance and to warn them and say, oh, by the way, we want to be transparent with you guys. We want to make sure we don't talk behind your back. And so what we're going to do is we're going to go ahead and on the fourth day of the month, you know, at 3 p.m., we're going to go ahead and drop the bomb. You know what I'm saying? We want to make sure we're just transparent with you. And we're taking our spy information and we're double vetting it by you guys. So we're asking you, are you, in fact, testing missiles over Japan? I mean, are you guys? Because we want to make sure we want to be over transparent. So, see, break that down. I mean, when do you engage in secret, covert sleuthiness? And when do you not?
Well, I think you kind of touched on it a little bit. You know, we if you go back and listen to some of the old podcasts or some of the podcasts, I should say, they're all old because they're all in the past.
They're new. See,
they're brand new.
New's the new hot. Nothing's old.
We put every show on our website as a podcast. You can go back and you can pick up these different shows. But we went over one with we talked about all the books that every entrepreneur should read.
Should read.
You get the first six, and I give a bonus seventh. And mine was The Art of War.
Yes.
And just like you said, I mean, you were very kind of cryptic, but you were saying, hey, if we're in war with somebody, then we should talk behind their back, and we should make plans without their knowledge, and we should talk about them. And sometimes in business, that's the case. That's what you do. And sometimes it is a little bit like warlike. And so when you're in that mode, when it's someone is,
screwing you.
Yeah, well, yeah, exactly.
Taking advantage of you.
Yeah, exactly. And someone comes and tattles on them, if you will, or tells about them, then that's something that, you know, you do want to talk about and then investigate, because you never want to make decisions based upon hearsay. You never want to make decisions based upon that.
So but let me give you two scenarios.
Start an investigation.
Let me throw three quick scenarios. Here we go.
Okay, boom.
Scenario number one. See, did you hear about Carol? Did you hear about Carol? Carol, I just want you to know. I mean, did you hear about it? I'm testing the waters. Did you hear about Carol?
Does this have anything to do with business?
Well, Carol works here, and I just want you to know I've heard.
Well, I don't.
Her and
you know
her
what?
Significant other are going a little, and I'm going.
I'd rather not talk about Carol if Carol's not here.
And then she said,
really have no
and I'm
comment.
Like, whoa.
And I don't. I don't even want to put that in my cranium.
Okay.
One of the things I always say to my kids too: ignorance is bliss. I'm like, sometimes I'm like, I don't want to know about it. You know, if it doesn't help me move the ball further down the field, why on earth do I want to take any of my gray matter and fill it with any of that?
That right there.
That science.
Woof. Now the next move. This is one where it's like, Z, real quick. Someone is currently downloading the database of our entire customer list.
Okay, now that's something that has my interest. That's a business.
It's on the server right now.
Let's investigate. Let's call my IT guy. Let's get. I got a couple of them. So boom, boom, boom. Make some phone calls and then let's investigate that. Now that's good stuff.
Now the final one. Z, I'm going through a little bit of a thing, and I just wanted to talk to you. And it's what it was I heard that Carol's gonna be leaving. I heard Carol might, you know, she might be leaving. I just wanted you to know. Maybe. I don't know. I mean, I talked to Bob about it, and it's just, you know, it could be a, you know.
Now, that's an interesting one.
Because that happens.
It happens, and a lot of times employees will tell other employees things they shouldn't, like, yeah, I'm thinking about leaving, or they may even try to be recruiting them, you know. And so that could be something you want to talk about. And
okay.
And then you want to talk to Carol about it and say, hey, you know. I just walk right up to him and called Carol to the office and say, hey, I've heard that you're leaving. Is there any truth to that? And she's going to look at you and say, absolutely not.
Absolutely not.
And then the next day she, you know,
I swear.
Gives her 2 weeks notice, yeah.
Now, move number 57 in honor of the Heinz 57 sauce people. And I want to get, Chuck, I want to get your take on this because you're a father, you're a business coach, you're a fabulous human. And we come back from the break, I want to get your take on this because as a husband, as a father, as a business coach, move number 57 could be huge. It's don't commit, don't overcommit to things. Do not overcommit to things. Don't say yes to so many things. Now your schedule's filled with obligations. See, I want to break down this concept of not overcommitting.
Oh, I'm going to commit to that.
Well, Z, I don't want you to overcommit, but seriously, I have a volleyball team. I'd like you to serve on the board and the panel at church, and I want you to volunteer for the volleyball team. If you could pick up some koozies, that'd be great. And there's a fun run on Thursday. Boy Scouts, we're trying to raise some money right now.
Can you bring oranges to the soccer game on Saturday?
Stay tuned.
Get ready to enter the Thrive Time Show on Talk Radio 1170.
Thrive Nation, we're talking today about getting things done, and we're talking about do not overcommit to things. Move number 57, do not overcommit to things. Now, I am going to go ahead and get myself in trouble. Other people don't have to join in my little party, my little attack of myself party. So it's a special party. I'm attacking myself. Here's the deal. I don't want to go to most things. So now I am all about, I'm 100% committed to going to certain things, but I'm not going to have a schedule. I am not going to have a schedule filled up with going to things that I don't want to go to. So as an example, I was invited by Dr. Z to go to the Steve Martin concert with Dr. Z. So I have a filter. One, do I like the event? Two, do I like who I'm going with? If I don't like the event, but I still like who I'm going with, I'll go to random things. If sure. I like, the people make it fun.
Yeah.
But if I don't like who I'm going with, I'm not going. But if it's a thing where I don't like the people who I'm going with and I don't like the thing, then I'm not going.
You're definitely not going.
And how do I decide who I like? I decide who I like based upon do I share the values of these people and do I have shared goals? That's what I do. Do I share the values and goals? So hockey is a sport that people in Oklahoma are playing. And they were a former client of ours, and I'm glad there's people who like hockey. But I don't at all. I don't like anything about the game. So I'm asked, hey, your son's playing on the team. You know, do you want to go to Rogers, Arkansas? I run it through the filter. Do I share the values? Most of the people on the team are great people, but they are 100% sold out on their kids getting a Division I scholarship to play hockey. Overall, big, broad statement, I don't like sports, just in general. Don't like them. No, I like the Patriots, certain anomalies, but I don't care. I don't want to play college soccer, college hockey. I don't care. It's not a goal on my list, whatever. So they're like, can you go? Then it's like, we're going to caravan 2 days before because we want to get there to watch the other team in Rogers. They got a newer stadium. We should go see it. And then it says, you know, we're going to go do a carbo load, the carb load the night before. Now, you're an optometrist, but I'm sure you understand how nutrition works. That's actually not a move to just sit there and gorge yourself on pizza
and pasta
the night before a thing. It's actually been proven to not be a good idea.
Yeah, exactly. But it's still kind of that myth.
It feels good.
It's kind of a, you know, urban legend.
No, I don't want to have any chocolates. I don't want to get any zits. I'm going to be carbo loading all night. So,
carbo.
So anyway, I don't want to point out the profundity of the concept that, one, the fact that you people don't know that carbo loading is not a thing. Two, there's a guy at the game who is a screamer. Every single game I went to, he's like, are you kidding me, number 12? Show some hustle out there. And you're like, who's he yelling at?
Come
it's his
on,
own kid.
Ref.
Oh, yeah.
Come
oh,
on.
Yeah.
You got him. And he just attacks the ref.
Come on, Billy.
He actually went as far as to walk onto the ice to question a call last year.
That's dangerous.
It's like 2 years ago. And he walks onto the ice and just starts freaking out. And I don't get it. So I used to go to the games when I had to go. And I'd put my hoodie on, I'd sit in the top left by myself, have a great time, good conversation with myself. As soon as the game's over, I leave. But when they said, hey, could you bring sports drinks? Hey, we're going to Rogers. Then they said, we're going to go to Phoenix. Phoenix, do you have any idea how far Phoenix is?
Oh, someone give me a handgun.
So I just said, you know what, I'm not going to be there. And I think I would have accepted as, okay, you're not going to be, that's fine. But there's people who then want you, they're like now champions of hockey, like, well, your kid will never play at the next level. And I'm like, I hope he does it. I've actually been doling his skates before every game. I mean, I've been putting ankle weights on him. I mean, I've been like, you know, making up rules. Like, hey, son, you know, whenever they blow the whistle, that means keep playing. You know, I mean, I'm always, and so, Z, what would you say to the person there who feels like right now they're listening, they feel overcommitted. They've over signed up for things. They've overcommitted. They're on all these boards, these church events, and the big networking, you know, the after hours networking where there's one every single night, your association for your profession. Help this person detangle themselves from the cobwebs of overcommitment.
Oh, baby, I like it, boy.
Oh, yeah.
We're
going to
come in raw on this one. I have a little rant.
Come on now.
I would like for someone to email me at info@thrive15.com and tell me the name of the individual who started, who made baby showers and wedding showers into couples showers.
That former Nazi.
I want to rant a little bit about that. That is the domain of women.
Not men.
That's not men. We are not supposed to show up and play can you put the diaper on the baby doll game.
Hey, Eric, did you bring the carrots?
Oh, I forgot.
Who started that?
I don't know.
If anybody out there in Thriveland knows
where's
who started that,
Dr. Z, where's
I want to know who it is. You know, one, those are things you'd never had to count on as a guy. Now you've got this thing of this awkwardness of, you know, your significant other saying, hey,
where are the pedophores?
Susie's having a couple wedding shower, and, you know, all the girls are, you know, taking their men, and, you know. You do want to go,
and then
right?
You're wearing the matching sweater with the girl you're with.
Oh my!
That's
gosh.
Another issue I have.
That's just one more thing you've got to fight through now. But you know, if you've got to learn how to say no, you've got to be a powerful person. You don't make all these silly excuses up. You just look at them and say, "I don't want to do that."
Yes, yes.
No, there's something just it just kind of just takes the weight off your shoulders. It's just enlightening. It's just refreshing. It's
takes
just to be
the
honest
off.
With people. You know, we're just told from a young age, oh, well, don't hurt their feelings. You know, you gotta
hurt those
you know,
feelings. Just
you know,
it.
Just you're not hurting their feelings. You're being honest with them. It's kind of like what they say when you break up with someone. Your best just to do it and don't ghost them. Don't just like, you know, all of a sudden you're not available, you know. And so the thing of what I'm trying to say is to be a powerful person. If you don't want to do it for those reasons you just laid out beautifully, Clay, I might add, if you don't want to do it, then don't do it. The worst thing you can do is be stuck at a, you know, your friend's kindergarten graduation of their kid going, oh my God, what am I
well,
doing
well, here's
here?
The thing is, my daughter used to go to Metro Christian, and there's about 25 kids in the class.
Yeah.
And I was thinking one day, I said, man, you know, I bet you all these kids have a birthday.
Most likely.
You know, I bet you all of them have a date of birth, or at least a time that we've let you.
We celebrated,
I'm saying to myself, man, if every one of these kids has a birthday, and we have to go to each one of them, man, that'd be 27 birthdays, man, so... That's a lot of birthdays.
It's like half a lot.
I'm not kidding. I started wigging out though with that feeling because we went on like every weekend.
He's shaking right now, Tosh.
We went to like multiple ones and run pretty soon. I said, "Get me off the crazy train.
Get me off the.
I mean, damn it.
Okay. Real quick question. What was the event that you went to in your life? You got to have one. Come on, you got to be thinking one.
I got it.
That you sat there and go, this, if I could shoot myself, I would, or if I could injure myself to get out of here, I think I would do it. What was it?
Any time for me that I travel in a car anywhere, I'm done.
Yeah, but you're such a horrible driver.
No, I mean, not only am I a horrible driver, but if anyone else is driving, I get motion sickness. So we decided to go to Colorado. And I loved once we got there, but I'm like, I can't do this. I start getting like not hives, but just I'm getting all worked out. I'm not kidding. I'm like sweat. Like, we've got to turn back.
We got to turn back.
It's like 30 minutes into the trip. She's like, are you kidding me? I'm like, no. And she knows, like, because we had agreed to go on this. And I'm like, you know what's going to happen. Dr. Evil's going to come out. You don't want.
Don't
and so we're
me.
About
don't.
8 hours into the trip. Now I'm getting motion sickness. Now we're into Colorado, winding roads, and I'm afraid of heights. I'm just afraid in general. So we're weaving through mountain passes.
Oh my.
And the guy we're with is a normal person. He's driving at a normal speed, but it's like 45 miles an hour. And there's no guardrails up those things.
I know, dude.
What's going on?
Did you
look
survive?
At his eyes.
Were they doing budget cuts up there in Colorado?
Did you survive, man?
Dude, it was the worst thing ever. And so I had my wife, we pulled over at a place where they serve adult beverages. And I went ahead and I did what I had to do. I loaded
up. Carb loaded?
I loaded up and I fell asleep in the back.
That's what I was going to say. That's what you need to do. You need to be pharmaceutically, you know.
No, but this is what happens
enhanced.
Is then every about 30 minutes, I wake up and have to go to the bathroom.
Oh, yeah. That's
and
the
so
move.
The guy we're with sure. is like, what is wrong with him? Why does he have to go to the bathroom every 30 minutes? But this is like, Because he drank like a half a bottle of vodka, to me. And so all I'm saying is, if you're listening to this show right now, you have to be a powerful person. You only live one time, and you've got to learn to say no. Chubb, is there anything you've been saying no to that you've said, "Die, that's it. I'm drawing the line. I'm no longer going to be in the Tattoo of the Week Club"?
Graduations for somebody that's not my kid.
Oh.
I went to my cousin's graduation out at Broken Arrow, and they had 1,900 kids graduating.
Shoot me.
It was like 3.5 hours at the Mabee Center over here, and I was just...
Next time it happens, we need to find a new member of the team. You need to pay them and say, when they announce this kid's name, freak out.
You just go for me.
And I'll say it with me.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah. Hey.
Cousin Jack, did you hear me?
It's like a huge arena. You can't even see who it is.
I'm just smiling across stage like, there's Clay. Yeah. Yeah.
Now, Thrive Nation, as always, we have 4 ways we can help you. 4 ways we can serve you. 4 tools. We have an unbelievable library of entrepreneurial tools, but we can't help you if you don't go to ThriveTimeShow.com. What's that website? ThriveTimeShow.com. Well, what's on it? There's four incredible tools. One, we have an online school. We have the podcast. We have one-on-one business coaching. And you can buy your tickets for our in-person workshops. There's 4 incredible tools to help you. But Z, knowledge without application is meaningless.
It is. Hey, when is our next workshop, by the way?
It's in December. Let me pull it up here on the incredible ThriveTimeShow.com.
8th and 9th? December 8th and 9th, I believe?
Oh, he knows all the facts.
Don't tell me I'm wrong.
Well, let me pull it up here.
Our last workshop sold out, so if you're interested in coming, if you want to be Rocky, and run up those steps with your hands held high and be victorious.
With fistful of cash.
Do we give out fistful of cash still?
That's a new move.
We give you the moves to get the fistful of cash.
Right.
That's what we're saying.
Well, Thrive Nation, as always, like to end this show with a boom. So without any further ado, here we go.
All together now.
Three, two, one, boom! December 8th and 9th.